appreciated. I'm very happy to introduce our next guest this morning. Jason McKenzie is 42 years old and is the husband of Tanya Ron and father of Chloe and Melody. Jason currently lives in London, Ontario, and Jason was married to Provincial Constable Cindy McKenzie. Cindy took her own life in March 2010 after a tragic struggle with bipolar disorder. Needless to say, it was an experience that forever changed Jason and his family. In choosing to share his experiences and what he's learned, Jason sees not just an opportunity, but a responsibility. His openness regarding the impact that Cindy's struggle has had on him and their children demonstrates the commitment, his commitment to living his life in a way that creates a place of safety for all people to be open about their challenges. Jason believes that through being vulnerable with one another, we can create connections that will change the world. Jason blogs daily at From Drunk to Monk. You might want to write that down, FromDrunkToMonk.com. And I've just recently discovered it in the past few weeks and have been entertained and moreover inspired. In one of Jason's recent blogs, he finished it off by simply asking the question, what have you got to be grateful for? And it caused pause for me, and I jotted down my thoughts, but there's some pretty profound thoughts from a very unique perspective from Jason on that blog, and I would certainly suggest checking it out. Jason has expressed his gratitude for the opportunity to join us here today, but really we are the ones, speaking of being grateful, who should be grateful for his courage and his generosity in sharing his story. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Jason McKenzie.
Good morning. You never know where life is going to take you. There's part of me that can't believe I'm standing up here doing this. And there's a much bigger part of me that knows that this is exactly what I should be doing. And that's sharing my experiences and what I've learned from them in order to help make a positive contribution. So thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. I'm profoundly grateful for it. This is Cindy McKenzie's story. This is my story, and it's a story. What's that? I tend to wander.
Hello.
So this is Cindy McKenzie's story. This is my story, and it's the story of our shared experience. There were so many moments where our journeys were so tightly intertwined, and there were so many more where they were desperately separate from one another, and I never knew what tomorrow would bring. So Cindy was my wife. 5.5 years ago, she took her own life after a tragic struggle with bipolar disorder. She survived by two beautiful, happy, and healthy daughters, Chloe, who's 11, and would probably want me to point out that she's very close to 12, and Melody, who's 10. Cindy fought valiantly against her demons, but they were relentless. And ultimately, she grew too weary to continue fighting. But Cindy was so much more than bipolar disorder, or so much more than a person struggling from mental illness. She was an amazing human being. She was a wife, she was a police officer, she was a mother, and she was a friend. And I pray that I can honor her legacy here today. Our reluctance to speak about mental illness is not really about mental illness at all. It's a fundamental fear that we all possess about being open, about the difficulties that we're facing in our own lives. We fear being labeled, or we fear being judged, or we even fear being persecuted. So how do we react to that fear? We hide. We hide from each other. And we even hide from ourselves. We make up stories and we rationalize away the behaviors and the aspects of our own lives that we know in our hearts that we need to change. And all the while we wonder why it is that people that are struggling with mental illness don't reach out to us and ask for help. So I want to ask you a question. I want you to think about this as I'm speaking to you today. Are you willing to become more open and share more of your story? Because if you're not, how can you expect somebody with mental illness to do that? So I'll use myself as an example. As a result of sort of the experiences I had with Cindy, I had a drinking problem for a long, long time. It was a way I used to cope with some of the things that I went through. And it really went on for a long time after Cindy's death. And in fact, I quit drinking about a year ago. But during the time that I was drinking, I didn't ask anybody for help. I didn't even admit to myself that there was a problem in the first place. I rationalized everything away. I hid. I didn't reach out for help. And the result of that was I stayed drunk longer than I needed to, but I helped absolutely no one during that time. In fact, I harmed people. But when I decided, you know what, once I quit drinking, I decided I'm going to share my story. I'm going to share what I went through. I'm going to share how I overcame it. I'm going to share what I learned from it. I'm going to share how I'm living my life now. I have helped so many people. But it was scary. It was scary to put myself out there. But I know now the power that comes from doing that. And that's one of the things I want to talk to you about today. So vulnerability is a key theme of my talk to you today. Because vulnerability is really a willingness and an ability to be open about the challenges we're facing and the things that we're struggling with in our own lives. Vulnerability is really driving a stake in the ground and refusing to be fearful any longer. It's creating a place of safety where other people can feel secure and comfortable to be more open about their challenges and their struggles. And finally, vulnerability will allow you to create connections with people that are so deep and so meaningful and that you would never have otherwise been able to create. It's just sharing more of your story, having the courage to share more of your story. So in the interest of walking the talk, I guess, and supporting the theme of vulnerability, I'm really scared right now, to be honest with you. It's not that I'm so much that I'm scared about speaking to such a large group of accomplished people about such an important subject, but I'm scared about not making the most of this opportunity. Because my goal is really nothing less than having every single person walk out of this room today committed to living your life in a way that creates that place of safety and security for all people to share their struggles. And I'm not just talking about people with mental illness. I'm talking about all people. That's how we can make a difference, and it's just a choice. When we do that, we don't have to wait for organizations to transform or new programs to be dreamt up and approved and funded and implemented, or existing processes to be tweaked. Because when we make the choice to live our lives in a way that is more open, all of those things will transform around us. And again, all we have to do is choose. We need to choose to become a beacon. We need to choose to become a source of inspiration and a source of light. We need to choose to become a guide to the safe harbors that we create by the way that we choose to live our lives. You know, mental illness is like a fog that obscures the beauty of those that are struggling with it. But our light can pierce the fog, and our light can warm the souls of the suffering. So I ask you to choose to become a beacon. The world needs you. We all need each other. So this is Cindy's story, and this is my story, but most importantly of all, this is the story of all of us. So Cindy struggled with mental illness her whole life. I see it much more clearly now than I did at the time. Hindsight and time has a way of giving you perspective. But what I want to talk about here is really the first phase of the last phase of Cindy's struggle with mental illness. And that was the phase where things really started to go downhill. I titled this slide Descent because it was that phase of Cindy's journey that was going from a life of, say, relative normalcy to the depths of emotional hell. It was, for me, it was the absolute most difficult time of the whole experience because I had no idea what was happening. I was watching my wife and my life fall apart in front of my eyes, and I had no idea what to do about it. I didn't know what was happening. I didn't know where to go for help. I didn't even know what help I needed. So it was a huge, huge challenge. So what I want to do is I want to talk to you about some of the things that, you know, bipolar disorder is characterized by periods of mania and periods of depression. So I want to talk about some of those things so you can understand what it's like. So the first part I want to talk to you about is the manic phase of bipolar disorder. So that was what really, I would say, I saw the most of, and that was the first part of the last, again, let's say the last 5 years. It could sometimes last for hours, sometimes it could last for days, sometimes it could last for months. And what really started to happen was Cindy started to become very, very angry all the time about everything. And I'm not just talking about like normal anger. I'm talking about a very vicious type of outrage. So I'll give you an example. And what she would do actually is she would, it would always be grounded in a kernel of truth to some extent. So she would latch on to something, some specific thing that happened, and then, you know, twist it and blow it out of proportion and make it into a really, really big deal. So I'll give you an example, probably something that many of you in the audience can relate to, leaving the toilet seat up. Okay, so bad habit of mine, I'll admit. But she would take that, something like that, and it would become an absolute cause of, like, moral outrage, right? About how I'm not respecting her as a human being, as a woman, I don't respect her as a wife, all these things. But it was like that about everything, right? So it all day long, I was the enemy, is what it boiled down to. During this time, Cindy also started abusing prescription and recreational drugs, as well as really abusing alcohol. She was very clever, though, in the sense that she would drink vodka, so I couldn't smell it, and she was hiding it around the house. And to this day, I still don't know where she got all the prescription medication, but it was the stuff like Xanax and all that, and it was an attempt to, I guess, calm herself down. So, but during that time, she was pretty much living on that. So she lost about 35% of her body weight in, you know, a few months. And it was terrifying to watch what was happening to her and to have no idea what it was. She would go for days without sleeping. And then she would physically collapse for, you know, not necessarily days, but a long time. However long it takes you to recuperate from not sleeping for days on end. She would disappear for days at a time. Actually, one time she disappeared for months at a time. She actually decided that she was going to move out. She needed to be in a town 3 hours away for the reasons that really don't matter. But so she left me with the kids. My daughters were probably 2 and 6 months or something at the time, and she moved away. Coming back occasionally, but you know, during this time, she checked herself into rehab because she could not admit she was bipolar. So she believed that the source of her problems were me and alcohol. So she checked herself into a rehab clinic. She ended up getting kicked out of the rehab clinic because there was no way she could abide by those types of rules. And at one point, she actually ended up in a homeless shelter. This is a police officer. This is my friggin' wife. Ended up in a homeless shelter in Windsor, 4 hours away from me, running around with meth addicts and, you know, just a terrible crowd. She spent tons and tons of money, like to the point of bankruptcy, or near bankruptcy. And for her, the reason that we had no money was not all of the stuff. I felt like I lived in an episode of Hoarders sometimes, but it wasn't all the stuff. It was that I was hiding money in offshore bank accounts. In retrospect, that probably would have been a good thing to do. But yeah, that to her, that's what was the cause of all of this, right? So that's kind of a Imagine that going on day after day after day and just chaotic behavior, organizing things to the point of complete disorganization, you know, never focusing, not being able to focus on anything. So, and making, just consistently making choices that led to terrible outcomes. And that's part of the insidious nature of this illness. So that sort of sums up the manic part. And the depressive part was unlike anything I have ever experienced. So I was in my early 30s, I would say, when this started to happen. And unless you experience someone who is suffering from depression, either as if you're the one suffering from depression or someone very close to you, you cannot even imagine what it's like. I thought depression was, you know, pull yourself up by the bootstraps, you know, the regular, you know, suck it up, get out of bed. Oh my God, it's nothing like that at all. It's inconsolable mental anguish, nothing short of that. It's every nerve ending on your skin feeling exposed. It's crying for days at a time, hardly being able to lift your arm to get a glass of water. But it was also, in some ways for me, much easier to deal with as the spouse than the manic phase, because she was home, and she was safe, and she was introspective. So where the manic part of bipolar is externalizing everything, and making, you know, seeing all the things that are not going right in your life and blaming them on external factors, the depressive phase was very introspective, obsessing on her failures as a wife, as a mother, as a friend, as a police officer, all of those things. So think of how bad the situation was that was the better of the two options. It's very, very difficult. So that's a summary of some of the things that Cindy went through. And this went on over a period of, again, I see it so much more clearly now, but the last phase of her life was about 6 years. So imagine living this pretty much every day for 6 years. So desolation. Desolation is really a state of emptiness or destruction. And that seemed like a pretty good word to sum up what my life felt like at the time. I obviously had sources of joy in my life. I don't want to make it sound like it was total destruction, but you know, I had my wonderful kids and family and friends and work. But boy, it felt like a lot of the goodness was gone. It felt like, you know, when you watch Oprah and you watch one of the guests on Oprah and they have this story that's happening to them and you watch it and you go, oh my God, that could never happen to me. That was me. I was the guy on Oprah thinking, what has happened to my life here? So I want to talk about a few of the things that led to that feeling of emptiness. Because when you're in a desperate situation like this, you want to be able to reach out for help. And when the help is not what you expect it to be or doesn't materialize, it has a very devastating effect on your sense of ever being able to overcome this. So let me give you an example. So first I'm going to say, I'm not here to besmirch the reputation of the profession of psychiatry, but I want to tell you what my experience was, because this was a really good example of a feeling of going from, oh my God, there's hope, to there's no hope. So once Cindy was finally diagnosed with bipolar disorder, she got referred to a psychiatrist. And basically what I thought was going to happen was, you know, I was so relieved. Oh my God, we got a psychiatrist. This is great. Cindy's going to go in there. She's going to lay down on his couch a few times, talk about her struggles and get better, and then we will just move on from this. No, that's not what happened. We lived in Orangeville at the time. She was very lucky to get 15 minutes a month. If it was a particularly bad month during the week that he would come around, she would get 30 minutes. And it basically went about 5 minutes of talking and then prescribing a medication. And then, see you next month. How's that working? Well, it's terrible. It's not working at all. Well, try this. Add this one. Next month, add this two and take away this one. There was a point where she was on four or five separate, like, extremely powerful psychiatric medications to the point where she was a zombie. She was hardly even alive, right? So imagine for her and for me, this was what I mean, you want to latch onto something so badly. And to have that just, I don't know, it was like sand through your fingers. That, oh my God, what do I do now? Is there no cure? Another place I reached out for help was Children and Family Services. So I will say that they were at one point helpful in the sense that Cindy had done some things to get them involved with our family, and they had prevented her from being able to be around the kids unsupervised. So it was, which was great, because that meant that I had some control over the situation. So she could not take the kids away from me. But near the end of her life, I had gotten them involved, and because she was in a really bad state, obviously, right before she ended her life. And 2 days before Cindy's suicide, they said, "We're going to close this investigation. There's no cause for concern here." So 2 days. So that's pretty tough, you know. When you really let me talk about the police, not the police in the sense that the her coworkers, but the police as a police service. So there was a couple times where the police came over to our house. One time Cindy decided she was going to move out. That time I was just telling you about, where she was going to move out 3 hours away. And she called the police on me, or she called the police to come, and it was the Orangeville Police Service, and they came to the house, and because she was afraid I was going to prevent her from leaving. She was completely intoxicated. She hadn't slept for, it was about 7 o'clock in the morning. She hadn't slept for a long time. And they came over, and they knew her too, personally knew her. And all they could tell me was, if you physically take the car keys out of her hand, you will be charged with assault. And if she had said you assaulted her, you'd be going to jail. What would that leave my kids? Would I leave them with her? Would they go to a foster home? So again, it's just a feeling like there's nowhere to reach out for help, right? So that obviously leads to, during this time, that leads to a profound sense of loneliness. My kids were very young. And again, I focused a lot of my efforts on trying to raise them and get them through this experience unscathed. But there was periods of time when they were young where they would live with my parents, 3 hours, 3 or 4 hours away, for sometimes 1 or 2 months at a time, because I just could not deal with all the things that were happening with Cindy and all the things, you know, all the other aspects of life. It just consumes you. You can't do it. So imagine, like, we had this pretty good life going. It was professional. She was a police officer. We had a swimming pool. You know, the whole typical regular dream life, right? Everything was great. And I would find myself sitting in my house in the dark, alone. My kids, my wife, I don't know where she is. My kids, 4 hours away, thinking, what happened? I don't even know how to process this information. So you got to find some way to cope with that. And this is, so when I talk about vulnerability, I'm going to be vulnerable right now. So what I used to say, when people would say, "How did you get through that?" I would say, you know, I did some things that I was proud of, and I did some things that I was not so proud of. And people would nod knowingly. But that's not good enough for today, right? I want to tell you some of the things that happened so you understand the impact of trying to deal with it and the impact it has not just on the person suffering from mental illness, but for the family members. So there was one time Cindy was in a very, very bad state, and I found out from a friend a particularly terrible piece of information, let's say. I'm sure you'll know what it is when I get to the punchline of this story. But I pulled the car over, threw up on the side of the road, turned around, went home, pretty much kicked open the bedroom door, woke her up, and screamed in her face that she was a fucking whore. I was also unfaithful. We hadn't been intimate for 2.5 years, and I was actually unfaithful while she was locked up in a mental institution. And, you know, you can always say, well, there's mitigating circumstances. Nobody knows what they would do in this situation. And that's all true. It's not about judgment. But the fact of the matter is, when you're in a situation like that and you do something like that, a piece of your soul dies. Because I got to look at myself in the mirror and say, I'm the guy that did that. And it makes dealing with all of the tomorrows that come afterwards that much harder. So, and I think the last thing I want to talk about on this subject is, and this is probably the biggest tragedy of the whole thing, was after so many years of nonstop chaos, I really lost the ability to see Cindy as anything other than mental illness. So there was just, I lost the ability to see the person, and all I could see was a mental illness because there had been so many things that happened. And, you know, and so for her, she wasn't close with her family to begin with, and that was one of the reasons that she had this lifelong struggle with mental illness. But, you know, as you slowly and continuously destroy your life by making all these bad choices, you push your family away, you push your friends away, you know, your career fails, you're left with nothing. The only thing she had left was me. Despite the fact that we were separated at the time of her death, but all she had was me, and I couldn't see past the mental illness. Where does that leave you? So I want to talk about Cindy's death, and I want to talk about, it's an experience you're not really prepared to handle, or it's so far out of your normal frame of reference that you really don't know how to handle it, but I want to walk through it. So Cindy was a perfectionist, so she gassed herself in her car. Okay, so what she did was she made a very elaborate setup with duct tape and like aluminum tubing or whatever, and she got in the car, hooked it all up. It was bulletproof. There was no way it was not going to work. She got in the car, turned on Q107. She was highly intoxicated at the time, and she ended her life. It's March 26, 2010. That was about 6 o'clock. She was actually, before I go on, she was found by a neighbor. Can you imagine? A neighbor heard music in the garage for a long time and went over to see if everything was okay, and that's what they walked into. So I found out, so this happened about 6, I found out about 12, by hearing voices inside my front door at about midnight. Jason, it's the police. We need you to come downstairs. Not the typical way you want to be woken up. So I came downstairs, and it was her sergeant, and he sat me down on the couch, and he said, "Brother, there's no easy way to tell you this. Cindy's dead." And I had two immediate reactions. The first reaction was, "Oh my God, what am I going to tell the kids, and how am I going to tell them?" The second one was overwhelming relief, and then guilt about feeling overwhelming relief, but relief that her suffering was over, relief that I could, my suffering was not over, but the constant chaos was over, that I could build a new life with the kids, but then feeling tremendous guilt about feeling relief. So it's not a pleasant experience. Then what happened, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, I guess, a couple detectives came down from the OPP and took me to the Orangeville police station to interview me, which, I mean, try to imagine this experience. I'm thinking, oh my God, she hated my guts basically most of the time. What if she wrote all these journals about all these terrible things I did? And, you know, I mean, you know, so it's just a surreal experience. So The detectives were extremely professional and very nice and very caring. So that lasted probably about an hour and a half. And then I came home and I stared at the clock, because every minute that passed on the clock was 1 minute closer to me having to tell the kids that their mother was dead. And I remember 4:14 stands out in my brain for some reason. It's seared in there. So the kids woke up and fed them breakfast, and Tanya, my wife, and my parents were there. And I sat the kids down on the couch, and I said, I have some really bad news for you. And they thought I was joking, because typically that would be followed by some kind of joke, but they saw that when I started to cry, that, you know, I was serious. And I said, I looked them in the eyes and I said, last night, Mommy died last night. And Melody, who was 5 years old at the time, her first question was, when is she coming back? I gave the only answer I could, which was never. It's not an experience I wish on anybody. So, this is a tough word, dysfunction, but I think it's appropriate. And it's what led me here today, and it's really what we're all facing here today when we try to make change. So, at Cindy's funeral, there's about 60 police officers that showed up, OPP constables primarily, and I had a number of them come up to me and said, you know, we knew how sick she was, or we knew she was sick, but we never said anything because we didn't know what to do. And, you know, we didn't want to ruin her career or whatever, so we said nothing. Cindy had gotten in a car accident the December before her death. Excuse me. And I had somebody come up to me and say, I believe she was trying to commit suicide at that time while on duty, because financially it would be beneficial for the family if she died while she was at work. But she never said anything until she told me afterwards. Cindy, the first time she was off work, she was off work for about 8 months. She came back and she was on light duties for 2 days before they put her back on the road, which she lasted about a month, and then she went off again. So like all these things happening led me to email Julian Fantino, who was a commissioner of the OPP at the time, and say, you know, I obviously don't blame the OPP for Cindy's death, that would be ridiculous. However, you are the leader of this organization, and you are responsible for creating the culture of this organization. That's what leadership is all about. And your culture is dysfunctional, because these are the things that are happening. So you need to own up to that, and you need to make a difference. So he put me in touch. I got in touch with somebody that reported directly to him. The name escapes me. Who put me in touch with Audrey Costello. So I'm sure some of you in this room know Audrey. She's an incredible human being, and it's been a real privilege to work with her. So that's kind of what led me here. So I want to talk about a couple of other things that happen. So we understand the enormity of what we're trying to accomplish here. So you see, I brought this, I'm sure you all know what a duty bag is, but I brought Cindy's duty bag up on stage. And I brought it up on stage because Cindy died in 2010. I had that duty bag returned to me this year. 5 years. So, to me, that is the only reason that could happen is because somebody did not care enough to do it. It was lost in a storeroom somewhere. So somebody didn't care enough to do the right thing. That is the only explanation for why that took 5 years. I got an even better one for you, or worse. When I first walked in to Cindy's house after she died, I walked in, I opened the door, all of her suicide apparatus was strewn all over the kitchen table. What if I had walked in there with my kids? What would I have told them? Girls, mommy's dead, but this is how the people that she worked with thought would be the best way for you to find out that she committed suicide. I don't even know what, is that apathy? Is that carelessness? Is it vindictiveness? I don't know. But that's what we're facing here. Another example is Cindy's detachment commander calling me and saying those, what sounded to me like scripted words at the time, if there's anything you need, if there's anything you need. I don't know what I need. She died. She just died. I have no idea what I need. No one told me what was available, you know, as for support, but just the words, if there's anything you need. And then I read in the paper 2 days later, because the paper had interviewed the detachment commander, we're supporting the family through this very difficult time. That's what we're facing here, right? And it's, I've got to be totally honest with you. Part of me, I absolutely recognize the importance of these events. They are critical. But part of me thinks that awareness is a euphemism for inaction. Because how can we not be aware? I mean, for as long as there's been police officers, they've been committing suicide, right? So there's been as long as there's been people, there's been mental illness. We're aware. We don't need more than awareness. We need action. And the best way to create that action is for every single person in this room and every single person you work with and every single person that they work with to make a choice to be different. That's how we will create change. Okay, so this is obviously a really good learning experience. So how have the kids, I mean, what happens to the kids after their mother dies? So obviously a lot of confusion, a lot of, I would say anger. I mean, they were relatively young, which was probably a godsend. A lot of tears, a lot of, you know, anger. Why does it have to be this way? It obviously changes over time, and I married my beautiful wife Tanya, who's now the kid's mom, the best blessing they could have ever received in their lives. They will appreciate it so much more. They appreciate it now, but as they progress, they will appreciate what an unbelievable gift she has given them. And so there was, you know, tears at night sometimes when we always talked about them, we were very open about it. There'd be tears at night when fatigue set in and they were in their rooms alone and they were looking at a picture of Cindy. Or as time passed, then there became feelings of guilt because they stopped being able to remember her. They stopped being able to remember the real, tangible kind of memories, and all they had left was a picture. And that's a really sad thing for a kid to have to realize. So I will say they're doing wonderfully now. In fact, it was just this year that we told them that Cindy actually committed suicide. So what we had said before was she had recently been back from a trip to India. It was kind of a last ditch effort, I would say, for her to try to save herself. And she came back, so we told the kids that she was jet-lagged and fell asleep in the car. So we told them just this year that their mother had committed suicide. So there was a lot of questions, but all you can do is answer to them to the best of your ability and make sure that they are aware that whenever they have questions, that they can ask them anytime, in any place, and we will answer them. And if we don't know the answer, we'll tell them. And if there's something that we feel like they're not ready to know the answer, that they need to trust us, and that we will tell them when we believe they're ready. So all things considered, right now they're doing wonderfully, wonderfully. So thank God for that. So and for myself, it's been quite a learning experience for me. I feel a great sense of responsibility to share my experiences and what I've learned from them, because I see that there's such an appetite for it. I mean, I've been involved with some mental health organizations and I've given some talks on mental illness and what I experienced. So back to Audrey. Her and I got together and the OPP was filming a training video on mental illness. And she asked me if I wanted to participate and tell Cindy's story, so I was happy to do that. It was a really great experience, very caring, and so the film, the video was professionally done, and it turned out great. And I put my section up on YouTube, and it's got almost 75,000 hits on YouTube. So it tells you that there's an appetite for openness and being able to talk about this. One of the things we did was we put together a lemonade stand. I'll show you a video here in just a second. But this experience was incredible. So we decided, the girls still to this day call Cindy Mummy in Heaven. And we decided that we would put a lemonade stand on for Mummy in Heaven. And the reason, what I wanted to do was I wanted to raise some money for the local chapter of the Canadian Mental Health Association. Because they just the most caring people, and they provided a spot for me that I could just drop in, especially at the beginning when I didn't know what was happening. I could just drop in there and talk, and they would explain things to me and just listen to me as more than anything else. So I thought, well, we'll just put together a nice lemonade stand. If we raise some money, that's great. I couldn't believe what happened. We raised $4,000 almost, and this was like on a cul-de-sac at the end of my driveway with some store-bought wieners. Needless to say, my dad was running back and forth like a madman after all these people started showing up. But, and we had police officers there. We had firefighters there. And the donations were so, so generous. But the most important thing, the most amazing thing that happened that I completely did not expect was the people came up to me in tears, sharing their stories. Police officers, firefighters, just regular citizens, and young, old, single people, couples, just in tears, thanking me for what I was doing. And I didn't get it at the time. I thought that they were doing it just because I gave them a venue. But what I didn't understand at the time, and I'll talk more about this after the video, is that they were responding to me, putting myself and my family and our experience out there. That's what they were responding to. And I didn't get it at the time, but I realize now that was an act of vulnerability, right? Because we were sharing our story and they reacted to it. And it was an incredibly powerful experience. So I don't know if the guys in the control room here can hit the video that's in the on the next slide. Oh, I have to advance the slide? Okay.
Lovely granddaughter, a princess of a girl. A lot of dreams came true the day you came to the world. Happy third birth, Chloe. Love Grandma and Grandpa Molly. We love you very much.
My favorite memory of my mom was when all the Christmas parties we had. My favorite memory of my mommy was when we sprinkled all over the cake.
I am Chloe.
I'm Melody.
We were doing a lemonade stand for charity. For people that don't have, like, their mom or their dad. And I'm guessing Mommy in Heaven's pretty proud of us. Because she can see us.
Thank you, Daddy, for taking care of us.
You're the best daddy in the world.
Is a blue shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you'd find a friend take you out of first flight and see the birds of the leaving her mouth. After the flood, all the colors came out. It was a beautiful day. Don't let it get away. Beautiful day. Touch me. Take me to that other place. Release me. I know I'm not a hopeless case. What you done?
So in the 5.5 years that have passed, I've been left with the, I guess the fondness that comes from remembering the good times while choosing to learn from the times that were more difficult. And I've learned a lot. My experiences have shaped a strong desire to lead a life of significance. And that significance is, or that life will be forever centered around finding new ways of being of service to other people. And sometimes the new is as simple as returning to the old, and that's connecting with people on an emotional and spiritual and deeply personal level. So, you know, what if instead of referring Cindy to EAP and having her fill out some forms, her boss had put his arm around her and said, "I know you're struggling. I've had my own struggles too. We're all human. You don't have to be scared." Or what if Cindy's team had gotten together and gone to her house and said, "We don't know what's wrong, but we care about you. We're scared, and you can reach out to us for help." Or if the organization was comprised of all kinds of people that were open to sharing their stories and creating a place of safety. What if Cindy felt like she could share her struggles without her career being ruined? We'll never know the answer to any of those questions because none of them happened. None. So, and you know, I don't want to make it sound like, well, let me phrase it a different way. I completely acknowledge that all your organizations are full of amazing people doing great work every day. What needs to change is the culture. And we have to stop being consumers, consumed by the culture, and we have to start creating the culture. And that's done by how we each individually choose to live our lives. That's why, to me, vulnerability is so important. Brené Brown is a researcher on human connectedness and vulnerability, and she has a quote I really like, and it goes like this. Vulnerability sounds a lot like truth and feels a lot like courage. And truth and courage are not always comfortable, but they're never weakness. And I think that's what's so important. You know, I'll just give you one quick anecdote before I wrap up here. But I was at work, and I thought, I've really started to realize how powerful being vulnerable is and putting yourself out there. And so I decided, you know, I'm going to share. I do this morning routine every morning, and I work in an automotive manufacturing facility, pretty hard scrabble, 550 people, blue collar, not really a new age audience, if you know what I mean. So I do this morning routine where I meditate and I read affirmations and write in a gratitude journal. And I thought to myself, I think I'm just going to write this all down. I'm on the senior leadership team of this facility. I'm going to write this all down, put my picture up, and put it up on the bulletin boards all around the plant. See what happens. So I'm sure that the majority of people, well, not maybe not the majority, but I'm sure plenty of people that saw that thought I was weird. But that's okay. They're wrong. So, but it's okay that they're going to think that. But what did happen was I had five people in person and five people via email come up to me and tell me their stories. Tell me things that they're struggling with that I bet they had hardly told anybody else there. Right? And it was an opportunity for us to talk, either again in person or via email. But that 10 people, it's a plant of 550 people. So I made a more meaningful connection with 2% of that plant, of that company, just by making that small effort to put myself out there and not being scared about what the consequences are, right? So small actions can make big change, but we just need to actually take action. That's what's most important. So I guess what I want to leave you with is I want you to think about some things, right? If you made the choice to become more vulnerable and tell your stories. It's not just about, you know, saying, oh my God, these are all the things I'm struggling with. It's sharing more of your story than you're sharing today is really all it takes. And being okay with that, knowing that you're worthy and that you have the courage to be able to do that. So what do you think would happen if everybody in this room decided to do that today? Do you think you would impact more people? Do you think you would create a place of safety? And if you created that place of safety, do you think that other people would reach out for it? I think they would. So I guess my question is, will you become a beacon of hope? Will you create a safe harbor? And will you stand watch? Will you shine a light? Thank you.
Jason, wow. Thank you so much. Just a small token of our appreciation for you having the courage to be here today. Just what a tremendous talk. Wow. It kind of gives new meaning to the expression when life gives you lemons, right? We all knew she was in trouble. That stuck out to me. How many times we've unfortunately had to hear those words or utter those words and look in the rearview mirror and know that something could have and should have maybe been done. The degree to which Jason's been able to take tragedy and turn it into triumph and change and become an advocate for hope and inspiration is inspiring for all of us. And how important vulnerability and being open can and should be. And it's kind of counterintuitive when we look at the work that we're in, because being open and being honest with each other, it's not always a good fit given our profession. But what a powerful and gut-wrenching, honest presentation. You know, looking back at the ups and downs and the degree to which you've been able to take tragedy and turn it into triumph and do what you're doing today and feel so strongly about it. Just hats off, man. Great job. Thank you so much. Thank you. So, Paul, good luck following that one up. Acting Superintendent Paul Johnston is a 31-year veteran of the Ottawa Police Service. Paul currently oversees the Central District Investigations, Human Trafficking, Street Crime Unit, and Break and Intersections. He also acts as a diplomatic liaison officer for the Ottawa Police Service. Paul's been a member of the Ottawa Police Senior Officers Association since 2009. He's held the positions of president and vice president, also served as first vice president of the Ontario Senior Officers Association. Superintendent Johnston works closely with the city's homeless shelters and sits on the board of directors for the Ottawa Mission. Paul also sits on the Canadian Association of Chiefs of Police Drug Abuse Committee. In September 2014, Paul acted as direct liaison to the Gadben family following the tragic loss of Ottawa Police Staff Sergeant Cal Gadben. Paul was his direct supervisor. He worked closely with Cal on several projects throughout his career, and he was also Cal's friend. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ottawa Police Acting Superintendent Paul Johnston.
Well, I think Jamie's right. This will be a tough act to follow. That was a spectacular presentation by Jason, and I think you're going to see some similarities from what you heard from Dr. Violante and what Jason said, and as well.